Please suppose our friend is very small, but he spoke about the other diversification yesterday. So please join me in giving him a round of applause.
Want to close the gap between theory and practice. We want to be a medical college where you study in the morning and go and see the patients in the afternoon. Management is what, you know, as Peter Drucker told, management is by practice. So we thought that like any good institution, you must see at this age a person who has been holding the saddle of a very, very important enterprise. Today, I have seen that we are surrounded by China on one side, we are surrounded by Pakistan on the other side. We have IS and all that. Security is very important, not only food security, not only income security, but food also, you know, securing our borders. And BDL is one of the foremost enterprises. Today when you talk of Mr. Kalam's program of missiles, people knew Mr. Kalam, but they didn't know that missile was being manufactured or missiles were being manufactured in BDL. And today, sitting at Hyderabad, we can target any part of the world. When Mr. Mantha took over, our missiles could reach only Sri Lanka or Lahore. But today we are in a position to target any part of the world. We can go to Latin America, we can go to Africa. Oceania, you think of a country and India can target. And the person and the team who did it or has been doing it is Mr. Mantha. Couple of more things. Mr. Mantha has been to Harvard and he attended there the most prestigious program of business leaders. And he had an opportunity of sitting around, you know, the heads of, you know, big enterprises like Microsoft. You talked of Google, is no more Google now. In a way, I think Google has been taken over. You talk of Lockheed, which is one of the most important, you know, defense enterprise, Coca-Cola. He had the time to, you know, meet and spend time with them, and then he had the best professors to interact with him. The best ones of the world. So you should be happy that you have a person of his stature over here. Not only that, I had the opportunity of working with him on the BDL board. And in the board meeting, we had all the three chiefs. Mr. Sihag used to sit, who, you know, commands, you know. We had Mr. Brownie, who was chief of the Air Force. The Naval Force chief used to be in our meetings. He knows ins and outs of several things. He knows where India is, he knows where India should go, he knows what's in the defense preparedness. But let alone you leave that. Now he made a company of 750 crores. I myself saw his leadership style. Where a company of 750 crores has achieved a target of 5,000 crores and is going to achieve 20,000 crores very soon. And maybe more than that. A time is coming very soon where Mr. Modi, our Prime Minister, is going everywhere and giving them, you know, PSLB 1, 2, etc., you know. Now, a time will come when Mr. Modi will keep on giving missiles also. And that, I think, it goes to BDL over there. When you do that, when a company goes from 750 crores to 4,000 and proposes to go to 20,000 crores and beyond, there are management issues involved. What are the management issues? One is thinking big. Can you think big and become big? Very, very important thing. I think your and my stature goes up when we sit with him. There are two ways, I think, you know. When you say you want to increase production, the one thing is that you increase capacity. The other thing is that you diversify. The third thing is that you take over. And you know, you have mergers, amalgamations, combinations. That is one way of, you know, increasing production. And you know, I think it's so difficult to start greenfield units. You know, I think when you talk of ease of doing business, it is so easy to talk about, you know, thinking about ease of doing business, but it's not that simple. You know, I think you have to go through a lot of paraphernalia. It is too difficult. But one way could be that you take over, you diversify. There are issues of supply chain management there. You know, I saw him, you know, struggling very, very hard because army generals, they want missiles today. But for missiles, you have to have power, I think, you know, in the front. You have to have, you know, production somewhere, you have to transport them somewhere, you have to do testing somewhere. How do you do all this? And all of them are scattered. All of them have to be done different times. How do you, you know, simplify the entire process? Supply chain management is a very, very big issue. Then the question comes from innovation. Can you cut short, I think, some processes? How do you do that? How do you train people? When he came, then BDL had about 600 to 700 people. 600 to 700 became 4,000 people. And then, I think he's the biggest asset builder. As asset builder, he set up a unit in Aurangabad with 800 acres, then another unit in Vizag with 600 acres, and made a company, you know, great company, you know, asset. Today, when you talk about SBI, how come SBI is very rich? SBI is rich because SBI has assets all over India. So when you look into SBI balance sheet, you find, I think, the two reasons, you know, for success. And is one of the first 100 top enterprises in the world. SBI appears there. But how does it come? I think this is the question that... Now the whole question there is that you are students of international business. This, I think, you know, defense is one area where every country is bothered and worried and can be, I think, a catalyst for increasing India's exports. We have the competence, we have the best engineers, we have the best minds, we have the best scientific establishments, and we have linkages, you know, all over the world. We believe in innovations, we believe in coming out new things, we believe in creativity. This all should help us. This all helps us, you know, in increasing the power of the missile. The distance that a missile, you know, could cover. Can we make our missiles sleek? That's the issue. Can we make missile, you know, target-oriented thing that, you know, it will go and hit, I think, at a particular point of time, you know. And if suppose there is a missile from the other side, can we change, you know, alter the way of hitting the target? So there is so much science, I think, in it. There is so much of engineering in it. There is so much of management in it. There is so much of manpower development in it. But before I finish, I want to leave a question with you. How do you judge the success of diversification? Correct? Diversification can't be for diversification's sake. It is not a fun. It is not a pleasure. It is a business game. And if that be that, then how do you do that? And I think the equation is very simple. And that equation applies both to diversification, also to mergers and acquisitions. What you do? You take M. Right? And you see that, you know, the market capitalization of the company, whether M dash is bigger than M or not. So when M dash minus M comes, then what do you get out of that? You get out of that the value that you have created. So any decision that you do, which should be, you know, judged in a long time a good decision, because you know you can't judge the decision in 1 minute or 1 day. But if you have to know the efficacy of a decision over a period of time, then you have to see whether your actions and decisions have the created value. That, I think, you know, is the yardstick to judge the success or failure of a diversification. Before I sit, I saw Mr. Mantha doing that. We had only one kind of missile from one, then we went producing a, you know, different kind of missiles of different ranges at different prices. at different supply periods, and I think it was that which made, I think, BDL a great turnaround company. When it took over BDL, I remember BDL was incurring a cash loss. But within a period of 5 years, from cash loss, it became to a cash profit-making company. And from cash profit-making company, it became a PBIT and net profit-making company, giving 30% dividend to the government. Only thing that we failed was that we didn't discuss. Because I was seeing him with defense minister, I think, as board member, we had enough opportunity to meet defense minister, defense secretary, and all those people. And whenever defense minister would come, I think he would always make mention the name of the BDL. So interest business is important, and let me again come back. I think our defense production can take us, to places, I think, in the world. So all that I wanted you to hear during my time, when I was a student in the universities, we could not see the face of a senior manager. But today, we are very lucky that Mr. Mantha, God himself has come to people. I'll say that way. That is one. Number two, don't think if you are seeing Mantha Sahib today, it is yesterday's work. No. I have been working on that for the last 2.5 years. And after 2.5 years, as I think Professor Menon told rightly, that great day has come. He has come out here. But then I have been in touch with him. He has taken the mission, and I have been requesting, I think, many senior, CEOs like him, please spend time with the students. When Mr. Kalam, when he finished his tenure as scientific advisor, he came to Anna University, and he started talking to students and teachers. And one day when he was taking class, then there was a phone call from Mr. Atal Bihari Vajpayee that we are thinking of making you the Prime Minister, the President of India. Would you agree to that? Anybody who goes to US, sir, you have been to US very recently, any foreign dignitary who goes to US, he has only two things in his mind. One, can he go to White House? Can he, and this is part A of one, and part B, can he address the Senate? And the second thing, whether Harvard would call him. Then what happens is that 99% they go to White House and also address Senate, but Harvard doesn't call. Going to Harvard is a very, very difficult thing. And therefore, universities and these institutions, they are the places where very senior people who have led the society and the government, we request them to spend time so that we can create young leaders who will have the saddles, of the country in their hand. Sir, before I finish, I'll take half a minute. Everyone, has a wish to go to Harvard. So, thus I want to make you happy before I go. Is that, in Saudi Arabia, Saudi Arabia? You have heard of it? Right? Richest people. The most expensive cars are there in Kuwait and Saudi Arabia. So one day what happened was that Saudi Arabian king, he loved, we love our pets. He loved his horse. Then somebody told, sir, you have, Saudi Arabia has invested 10% of money in Harvard University. Why can't you ask Harvard University to give a PhD degree to your horse? But this is a big problem, because Saudi Arabia is a very close ally of the US. And this also reached Mr. Nixon. He was then the president. This is a true story. And Nixon was in TG, that if he doesn't fulfill, then the relationship with Saudi Arabia will be very sore. So this discussion went on. He called, the dean and the, we called president there. president of the Harvard University and ask him, please, you have to do this. How do you come out of this? How do you wriggle out? If you don't wriggle out, our relationship will be in problem. We'll lose a great ally. And here, you know, these people who are with the king, you know, they were always, you know, saying, sir, that reply has not come from Harvard University. When they'll have a special convocation for the host to get the PhD degree. But you can understand that Harvard president had a group of 3 students, very bright students. Nobody could solve this problem. He gave this problem to these 3 students and asked them to give a solution. Nobody could give, even the robot could not give the solution those 3 students gave. And the solution was, they wrote back to the king of Saudi Arabia that Harvard gives PhD degrees to donkeys but not to horses. We give degrees to donkeys but not to the horses. This is how they came out. Friends, I think you are doing a very, very important course. And today you have a very important person here. Please listen and understand and try to move up and touch the sky. Thank you very much.
So, good morning. I must thank Professor Mishra for this, but I don't deserve all this praise. I am a simple man. It's more than sufficient for me to have a simple living. But I will be telling you my experiences on diversification, how we practiced it. So, BDL was formed in 1970. It was asked to be to manufacture an anti-tank guided missile. It's a first generation anti-tank guided missile. This was to meet the requirement of the services, as there was no development in the country. No development was being taken up, so it is in the country. And this was under collaboration from France. Under license agreement, a G2G agreement had been formed, and BDL was asked to manufacture these missiles. At that point of the time, DRDO was very in a nascent stage, and they did not taken up, or they had taken up, but it did not succeed or some part of it. So there was no missile available with the country. Whatever were available were purchased. So this was the first company to manufacture the first type of missile, that is a first generation anti-tank missile, where the control is through joysticks. Many of you play video games, so you have joysticks. That is the control it had. Then the missile takes from the launcher and goes to the target with the help of. That means there is a man in the loop who has to control the missile to be taken to the target. As the aerospace industry was in the very beginning stage, so most of the components had to be manufactured in-house. How many of mechanical engineers? Nobody. How many are engineers? Oh, plenty. Good. So you understand what are forgings, castings, etc. So those were only procured from outside, and some simple components. But other all critical components were being manufactured in the factory itself by establishing the capacities, by keeping the machinery. Apart from this, all the sub-assemblies, sub-assemblies, integration, testing were carried out in-house. They were not subcontracted. So the core competency of the company was that they will have integration and testing, they will have manufacturing and explosive handling, because missile is basically an explosive item. So this continued up to 1978, when the desired quantity had been completed and handed over to services. Please interrupt me wherever you have a doubt and ask. So from 1979 to 1982, there was no work. There was no missile. So BDL was only supplying to the maintenance requirement of already supplied goods, and then the servicing requirement if any is there, spare parts, etc. But practically there was no work, and company was in doldrums. In 1982, they signed second agreement with France to manufacture a Milan 2 missile, a 2 kilometer range anti-tank guided missile, semi-automatic, where this man-in-loop position is removed, and it was a wire-guided missile, tube-launched. It was under collaboration agreement. That means the transfer of technology would take place in the form of fully formed, semi-knockdown condition, completely knockdown condition, and indigenous manufacture. You understand that, FF, CKDs and SKDs? For any technology to be transferred from a different country to our country, these are the stages followed. And if you see, normally 1 to 2% is taken as fully formed, 2 to 5% of the quantity is taken as SKDs, 5 to 10% is taken as the CKDs, and the rest is indigenous manufacture. So this gives time for them to understand the technology to be absorbed, and then, and also in continuation the production is running. So it's a gradual transformation of technology coming from one country to the other part of it, or one company to the other part of it. So by 1986 the machinery etc. has been installed, and by 1989 the indigenous process has started. And some components were already made, some more were in the process of development, etc. part of it. At this point, let me first define what is diversification for you. This is from book and internet, so you need not worry much. So what does it say? That it's a corporate strategy to enter into a new market or industry which the business is not currently in, while it's also creating a new product for that new market. Am I clear? Or any clarification required? This is most risky as the business has no experience in the new market and does not know if the product is going to be successful. It's clear? So if we go to the growth strategies versus product versus the market, then you will have ANSOF matrix, you must have read it already. You will have these 4 points, 4 quadrants coming out. Market penetration, that is the same product into the same market asking for additional orders, indirectly saying that asking for additional orders. Product development, that means either an upgrade of the product or a new product is introduced, but to the same customer or same market. Market development, there is a different customer available, but product remains the same. Diversification, new product and new market. It's clear? So now what happened is 1982 we signed agreement for Milan 2 for 2 kilometer range anti-tank guided missile. In 1983 IGMDP was formed. How many of you know what is IGMDP program? Professor Mishra was explaining that. It's the program started by Dr. Kalam. Integrated Guided Missile Development Program, started by Government of India, wherein 4 missiles were to be manufactured, were developed by DRDO and BDL to manufacture these missiles. One was an anti-tank guided missile, it's a third generation, that is fire and forget type. The second one is a surface to air missile, Akash. Third one was a battlefield missile, Prithvi, 150 kilometer range, and fourth one was anti-missile missile, a sea skimming missile called Trishul. These were the 4 missiles planned to be manufactured under the IGMDP program and to be developed by DRDO and to be manufactured by BDL. So by 1986 the construction work and all started. BDL started creating the facilities, and by 89 the machines had been positioned, manpower has been recruited, trained, and kept in place to start manufacturing the developmental missiles. And most of you know that production for development is much different from production for supplies. Am I clear the difference between the two? It's clear? Fine. So this was for production for development. So in 1986, Government of India signed another contract with Russia, at that time Soviet Union, wherein to manufacture another semi-automatic anti-tank guided missile called Kankus, a 4 kilometer range. And since both were from diverse countries, what is one from France and other from Soviet Union, at that time it had not broken up till now. So practically it was not advisable to manufacture at the same location due to some constraints imposed by them. So it was a different unit was created, which is near Patancheru, about towards Shankarpalli, some of you know the place, where ordnance factory is there, by adjacent to ordnance factories, and facility started creating. By 1989, we had created the construction work, and by 1991, the machines have been installed and commissioned. At that point of time, I think BDL was one of the first industry which had 100 CNC machines under single roof. So all the latest machinery has been put, manpower has been brought, and work started for this. This was also through the technology absorption by license agreement. So we will have the fully formed, the SKDs, the CKDs, and the indigenous manufacturer. So if we come back to the ANSOF metric in 1991, market penetration, we already have orders for two missiles, that is Milan 2 and Kankus. Product development, DRDO is already doing the product development part of it. Market development, no action has been taken, all are for Indian Army only. Diversification, not required as of that stage, because there is ample work available, part of it. But what happens to our machinery, what happens to our capital utilization? Anybody? What happens at this stage? There are more than 100 machines available, manpower available, where is the training for them? Where is the output and where is the revenue out of that part of it? Because value has to be added by thing. In the end of the day, you start a thing, how much revenue has been given is the net result. What is the revenue added from this part of it? And then what do we do at this stage? How to get revenue from that? Anybody? Any idea? So what we decided was that this will not work. We need to go to diversify. But what was our attributes are at that point of time? Missile production is done in batch quantities, that is in small quantities. It's a high cost item, very costly, highly capital intensive, and stringent quality being single shot device. Once the missile leaves the launcher, all you get is few debris. Nothing else you will get. Because it is filled with explosive, it will go and hit the target, or it will fall on the ground, it will explode. It's a single shot device. So this being the attribute, the machine is also built to these attributes. Then how do we go about it? Now how do we go through the diversification process, keeping this in view and to ensure that we get revenues out of that? What is the method available to us? Any idea? So what we did was that we went around Hyderabad to get any product. We couldn't succeed. We then sent teams all over the country to ordnance factories, HAL, Maruti, Aisha Motors, BHEL, anywhere, if we could get jobs, for our machines. So when we assimilated this data, we found that if we take a component from any one of them, we need to invest money for SPMs. SPM means special purpose machines. Apart from our machines, we need to invest, or we need training for our people for to manufacture that component. So this being scenario, it doesn't work, because it becomes a vicious loop. You invest money, you get machines. To run the machine, you invest money again. It doesn't work. So finally, after the data has been assimilated, we narrowed down to two products, which were fairly costly, which were capital intensive, where our machines could be utilized except for two components, and were highly stringent quality. One was a 9 mm pistol and other was 7.62 self-loading rifle. Now, missile manufacturing is one type of manufacturing. Pistol and rifle manufacturing are entirely a different type of manufacturing. So we came back to what is called, this is how our core competency utilizing to add value to the company, we had to diversify. Understood? This was in the year 1991. So 91 to 94, we continued to produce. We did not face much problems. So now, as against single product of SS-11B1 anti-tank guided missile, we had four products. One was a Milan II anti-tank guided missile, others was Concourse anti-tank guided missile, pistol 9 mm pistol, and 7.62 self-loading rifle. In 1994, the first development missile Prithvi came into existence. The development portion has been completed and they were cleared for series production. So we got the fifth product, and it had a range of 150 kilometers. We took over and started, facility has already been created. So migrating from development to series was not much of a problem, as the manpower has been concurrently trained. But we faced a threat on Milan II missiles. They said that they are likely to short close. So we are back to square one. Now what to do? Already one good product which was giving revenue was threatened to be short closed. Then we asked why. Why it needs to be shortlisted? Why the customer doesn't want the product? They said that as per the categorization, a launcher should have X number of missiles. So if they have Y number of launchers, Y into X is the number of missiles what they want. Let us say for discussion's sake, one launcher will go with 10 missiles. So 1000 missiles, if they have 100 launchers, is the end. They don't want beyond than that. But I said, do you have requirement? He said, yes, we have requirement, but we cannot go. Why the launchers are less? It's very costly. In those days, it was costing more than a crore. I'm talking of 86, 87, 91. That is the period. It was very costly. Whereas missile cost 6 lakhs, 8 lakhs, 12 lakhs, that's all. Then we said, no, this doesn't work out. We have already faced two typical situations. 79 to 82, no work. 91 to 94, almost no work. We can't have our manpower being idling, because idle manpower will create a bigger problem than we will now search for product. We went to Army and we found out that they have old launchers available called fagot launchers, which were used for some missiles which had been purchased but now have become obsolete and will not be used. We brought that launcher to our in-house R&D, modified it, and a new product came out in 1994-95. That was called Flame. Fagot launcher adapted to Milan equipment. It was purely innovation. And BDL holds the patent for this even till today. This was discussed with the designers of France, and finally they also cleared it after testing. Yes, this meets the requirement in all respect. So a new product came into being for to be delivered to army. Subsequently, our Milan II missiles life got extended, because they had more than at less than 1/5 cost of the launcher. See, it met all the requirements. Functionally it was meeting, cost was also less than 1/5. If it is 1 crore, it was less than 20 lakhs. So this being the scenario, a new product started entering into the field of this thing, that is called flame launcher. So now we have 6 products. So where we were threatened that a missile line would close, here that has been revived along with a new product line. Now what happens is, what is an anti-tank guided missile? Anybody can explain? It is to destroy, what is the target? Tanks. So what is the cost of a tank? Approximately about 18 to 20 crores. And cost of missile? Around 10 lakhs, 6 lakhs, 8 lakhs, 10 lakhs. So which is cheaper? Which is beneficial? Which is to be protected more? Tank. Tank has to be protected more. Because you can fire not one, you can fire 3-4 missiles on one tank also. So all over the world, the innovation took place, and a plate called explosive reactive armor has been developed, which are fitted onto the surface of the tank. So when the incoming missile comes, this explosive reactive armor touches with the missile, and it missile gets exploded. Tank is safe. So this is called the countermeasure. So now your 10 lakh missile or 12 lakh missile cannot destroy the 20 crores tank. So as a counter to countermeasure, they came up with a one more warhead into the missile. So now missile contains 2 warheads. One warhead to destroy the explosive reactive armor, and the second warhead to penetrate into the tank. Even again, cost is just marginally increased by about 1 lakh or 2. So again the threat has started. But all over the world, the tanks have been modified. So these missiles became practically not useful to the services. And Concus was the first missile which got upgraded, called Concus M, that is modified, with a 4 kilometer range. That has happened in 1998. Milan II got upgraded as Milan IIT, called tandem warhead, Milan IIT, and it got upgraded in 2002. So by 2002, 2 product lines got stuck. There is no Milan missile, there is no Concus missile, because services don't want it anymore. Whatever inventory is there is sufficient enough, and they will go for the new missiles. So we had to again go back to the collaborator, get that revised technology, and start manufacturing, which our services want, Indian Army wants. So what have we done? We have gone for product development. It goes through transfer of technology. Both the things through transfer of technology, but we have gone for product development. So 2004 onwards, the Concus M production started. And 2008 onwards, Milan IIT production started. Even till today, the production is going on. There is no further counter or counter measures available for that, neither in the tank side nor in the missile side. But one area totally we have not touched is market development. One area totally not touched is market development. So in 1996 or 97, what we decided was that we have been supplying all our products to Army. Let us now give some products for Air Force. As you all know, Air Force, when the aircraft is purchased, along with that, they also purchase the weaponry system, missiles. And the quantities being so low that they were not feasible to be manufactured in the country. To manufacture, I told you around 2%, 1%, 5 to 10%, say 20% also is through transfer of technology, remaining 80% indigenous has made. But the quantity, if it is only 100 numbers, 500 numbers or 1000 numbers, it's not economically viable to manufacture. So no such program was there with the Air Force. We wanted to enter into the market of Air Force. So what we told them that, how do you protect your aircraft against the missiles? So they came up with, there are shafts and flares which they are thrown from the aircraft when an approaching missile is observed, and that has the same frequency as that of the aircraft which diverts the missile. It's a passive protection. We said we will develop it for you. And by 2006, for the first aircraft, the shafts and flares have been developed. And as of 2014, almost about 4 or 5 types of aircrafts have been fitted with BDL made shafts and flares and BDL made countermeasure dispensing systems having shafts and flares, and for the others the development process is on. So one more product got added up into the arsenal and one more customer got added up with us. Prithvi was the P1, 150 kilometers range was manufactured, delivered. Then we said that any upgrade on that. 2002, an upgrade came for that, which was done by DRDO, and P2, a higher version of Prithvi, came into existence, which is 250 kilometers in range, and then further upgrade of it, 350 kilometers in range, came into existence. So we started manufacturing from 2003 onwards the Prithvi P2 missiles. Along with that, for Indian Navy, the naval version of Prithvi called Dhanush came into existence. So that was also manufactured from 2004 onwards. So now we have a battery of products. Then in 2008, surface to air missile came into existence. The third product from DRDO came into picture, and Akash, the first order was received in 2009. It was for Air Force. Then we decided that no, Akash can be sold for Army also, because from borderline it can be fired on the approaching missiles. So we scored on that, and 2012, the first biggest ever order from Army for Akash came to us. And here we graduated from missile manufacturing to weapon system delivery company. That means apart from missiles, we also manufacture launcher, power system vehicles, radar, etc. Was manufactured by others, but assimilated and given by us. So we diversified into a weapon system delivery company rather than a missile manufacturing company. In 40 years time, that is the diversification we took. All this we have been doing, but one customer is still untapped. That is Indian Navy. So we felt that no, we have to handle it, that also, and prevent situation which has arrived in 79-82 and 91-94. So the first product what we made for Navy was submarine fire decoy. The engineers would know better that anything moving on the surface on the ground and anything flying is much difficult than the moving on the ground. And anything moving underwater is even difficult than what is moving on the air. So that is the gradation what you have. So submarine fire decoy was the first product for Indian Navy developed by DRDO, manufactured and given by us. The next step what we took was, having now given decoy to deflect the torpedo, why not make the torpedo itself? So you give them both armory as well as how to save it. And TAL, advanced lightweight torpedo, was designed by DRDO, and in 2011 we received the first order for TAL. By 2014 the supplies have been completed and awaiting further orders. Now both have been done, then we want that anti-torpedo decoy systems to be created. But DRDO is not developing any such product as of now. So we went to and scored around the market, and we found that Italy is ready to give us this technology. So under transfer of technology, we signed an agreement with government of Italy and company called VAS Italy, who gave the technology to us and were delivered, given to Indian Navy to be fitted in all submarines of the country. That job being completed, it has now come with an upgrade. It is called C303S, which now in the Scorpion class of submarine is being fitted. So now, what does our matrix look like? If we go for market penetration, we already have orders for 3 ATGMs. One is anti-tank missile, one is Milan 2T, other is Concourse M, third is Invar. Invar was in 1999, second plus generation laser guided to be fired from T-90 tank. This is the only missile which comes out from the barrel of the tank. And that has been signed. It has a range of 5.5 kilometers, fitted with tandem warhead. So 3 products coming out under market penetration. Under product development, Prithvi has come from P2, it is the indigenous development, and then TAL has come, submarine fire decoy has come, C303S comes under market development, where from Indian Army to Indian Air Force to Indian Navy we have gone, and diversification of course, pistol and rifle. Any questions? I'll come. I told you that due to 2 components we could not make. One was the barrel for the rifle. Now it is made through cold swaging process, and cost of the barrel was very high. Second thing came in, the machine was costing those days about 6 crores. So now an upgrade took place in the rifle called INSAS 5.56. So once INSAS 5.56 has come into picture, nobody wants 7.62 SLR. So there was no product market left for it. We had to close. Of course, when I take the strategic planning class, I will explain in detail some of the other factors which have caused this problem. Under diversification, I have not touched that. Under strategic planning, it will come in a detailed explanation.
Even today, it's a 4.4.
AK-47 is 4.7. Yes, they are complaining, but not yet come. But you are right, it may come any time.
So what are the problems faced by the changing of the band from 7.62 to 5.56, the tender which was
there? Whatever we could manufacture based on the requirement we made, further not possible, not required. So we had to stop. Since we had not invested in machinery, machinery we invested was only for Concourse. So it continued with that. And Concourse M, it got absorbed. Fine. Let me touch the last point on this. the risks involved with the diversification. Diversification has the highest level of risks. Going into unknown market with an unfamiliar product offering means lack of experience in the new skills and technique required. Company puts itself in greater uncertainty. Diversification also necessitates expanding of human and financial resources, which may detract focus, commitment and sustained investment in core functioning. It should be only chosen when current product and current market orientation does not offer further opportunities for growth. I have completed. Will you have any questions? You plan to touch in the strategic planning class. The planning is never done for the quantities demanded. We always plan for 20% search requirement to meet any eventuality, except for the manpower, machinery, space. We require lot of space because building to building, you cannot have a building like this. There is a minimum space required because of explosive requirements. So we need, like our Banur complex is 1000 acres. And you will find one building here and building scattered other, magazine somewhere else, administration block somewhere else. And in between you cannot construct because these are stack requirements and we have to adhere to this. And every year they are inspected by government agencies. So we plan for everything except manpower, because I am manpower, we cannot have idle quality. And search can be met through overtimes, through other means available for us. So that's how, not only at Kargil, at many, many other times also, we have met the requirement. Then enhancing the capacities. From 2000, we have touched last year 4,800. With the same facilities, no facilities have been changed, no addition has taken place. So search can be met. That is planned in the beginning while construction itself. For machinery, if it is an SPM sort of a thing, yes, we will face constraints, then we will run third shift. We normally plan for two shift running. We'll plan the third shift. If it can be outsourced, we'll go for outsourcing.
So you have not spoken about the manufacturing.
It is manufactured, it is done. I did not speak because of that. So that we will discuss when we go out of the room. Because of that, I did not speak. All outside that room will speak, no doubt. And it is manufactured in this premises. It is hardly 5 to 7 kilometers from where you are sitting. We are not an aircraft company. Please ask HAL. HAL and ADE and ADA, NAL. Those are the people to discuss for aircrafts. What missile they want, they have to spell out. BDL as of today does not manufacture any air-to-air missile because there is no development taken place past. Presently, it is under progress, a missile called Astra, which is expected in 2018. So once it comes, BDL will manufacture. It's involved in the development stage. BrahMos is a joint venture between Government of India DRDO and USSR, and it's a 50-50 joint venture, and it's a cruise missile. It's a battlefield cruise missile. We don't make that.
Product
We don't make cruise missile. Pinaka is a rocket motor, not a missile. The difference between rocket and missile is known to you? There is no guidance and control. In rocket motor, there is no guidance and control. If you add guidance and control to it, it becomes missile. Pinaka is manufactured by ordnance factories. Ambachari, ordnance factory Ambachari is made. The first rocket motor for 700 Pinakas were made by BDL. Later on, it has gone to outsource. And some company in Pune, some company, they make it. No. We don't make any more of that. But initially, from the period of 95 to 2003, the rocket motors were made only by BDL for Pinaka. The main rocket motor casing, inside material is again made by ordnance factory. Yes, there is only Akash is having a range of 25 kilometers and a height it can go is 18 kilometers. Whereas you can have a median range SAM which is called 70 kilometers, Akash cannot go there. And country still under development for MR SAM. This to next strategic planning class I will take, I will explain in detail. I have not touched certain portion of it. There may be a little repetition here and there, but it will be touched. Yes. Yes, under collaboration from Israel, MRSAM presently for Navy is getting ready. It will be followed by for Air Force. Yes, INS Vikramaditya is going to be fitted. Navy, for Navy it is going to be made and delivered.
Is there any threat to
media
from the present
making
India? Because
please don't
have any private.
So,
okay,
comfortable.
Because like, many licenses are given to private companies for manufacturing inside.
The core competency of BDL is handling explosives. Which private factory is ready to handle explosives? And I told you land. 1,000 acres land where buildings are distributed and all. Which investor will like to keep? Your two buildings are hardly 15 meters away. Mine will be at least 150 meters to 200 meters. Something like 400 meters. Sometimes 2 to 3 kilometers.
We have already taken land for it.
in a place called Amaravati, which is in Maharashtra, not Andhra Pradesh, in Maharashtra. We have 500 liters of already. So, sir, we would like this thing. So, what we will do is we will catch up again next week. I'll make one or two promises. One promise is we do not have that equation. So that you have freedom of speech and you will be learning something. That's one.
No, in that particular part
of the world. Yes, especially in one very, very sensitive.
We understand
that. So I hope you enjoy the session. Thank you very much.
Thank you.